So, do you think it's worth mentioning El Caro expanded in the 80s and other?
There was a, I don't know the specifics other than I do know that for El Caro Park, there was an opportunity to acquire the agricultural piece that was north of El Caro Park. And the city was motivated to do it for a couple of reasons. One was it allowed for a dedicated soccer field, which the city had none. And so the north expansion is a soccer field. But it also was a time when the city acquired and worked with Girls Incorporated for their facility. So that all happened simultaneously, where the city acquired the property and then found a way to convey a portion of it to Girls Incorporated. At the same time, the water district acquired an easement or a location there to build its water well.
Anything more about Tomal Park, how that came together and what's worth mentioning?
Yeah, the Tomal Interpretive Play Area is named aptly because it's within a park system, and the state Parks and Recreation folks designated it as an interpretive area. And it's unique in the state park system because you won't find, I'm told, a new playground anywhere in the state of California on state property or in the state park system, except in Carpinteria. The brainchild was of the Rotary, Carpinteria Morning Rotary, who wanted to place a playground in the Linden Field, but that was not going to happen. The state wasn't happy with that idea. And also the Rotary had this idea of building a self-built project out of wood. So the original concept was fascinating, to have a playground for kids downtown, but the execution they were proposing wasn't going to work. It was creative because the state had purchased a strip of land along the railroad tracks that had not yet been folded in, at least from a planning perspective, into the Carpinteria State Beach campground facility. So in a way, it was a little strip of land that did not have a plan. And slowly but surely, with the cooperation of the Rotary and the state parks folks and the city folks, it evolved into what you see there today. So it's a children's playground, but it's got a very strong interpretive element of the Chumash, and it is an expression of the story. It's a very adoring story of the legend of the Rainbow Bridge, where Chumash were on Santa Cruz Island and they wanted to come back to Carpinteria, and so a rainbow was created for them to come back, and anyone who fell off the rainbow were turned into dolphin. And this is all by all scripted in the story of the Chumash legend of the Rainbow Bridge. So it was a very fun project for me and the rest of the team because we got to be about as creative as we'll ever get to be on a park project. Had a great time.
And who was it paid for by?
A variety of sources. The Rotary contributed a very big majority of the funding. We were able to get a grant from the Land and Water Conservation Fund, and the state parks staff helped steer that grant to us. It was actually previously programmed for another state park unit, but it seemed to be whatever state park unit that was not going to be able to execute the project. So we got it transferred to this project. And then the city of Carpinteria contributed park improvement funds, which is a development impact fee fund that we have toward the project. And at the same time, we built the Palm to Linden Trail, which is connected physically, but it was really a separate project. And that was funded almost entirely by a recreational trails program grant through the federal government.
And was the Tomal Park done in about 2014 or 13?
I would say 13, yeah. 2013. It's probably been out there, maybe even 2012.
How about the Franklin Trail? Tell me what you can about that.
That was a project that's mostly in the county, and I think a couple of very motivated individuals, Bud Gerard and Jane Murray, helped to galvanize a group to fundraise. It was way more expensive than you think it should have been, just to get out of the urban areas down below. A lot of fencing, there was a bridge that had to be purchased and installed, a lot of landscaping. Typical conditions of approval that a planning agency might put on a project aren't excused when you're doing a park project or a trail project. So they had to meet a lot of environmental conditions. And they raised this money and put this trail in, which is fantastic because it connects our watershed to our coastal areas. So for the first time again, Carpinterians have an opportunity to hike up into the watershed behind us. And there is a huge, vast area that's very pristine back there that is, it's fascinating in the sense that it is part of our watershed. And to be able to go up into the hills and experience those elevations and capture those fantastic views and see that environment, but then in the same day walk down and put your toes in the ocean is pretty fun.
This city has a lot more open space and parks than most big cities, eh?
Well, when you add in the big nature parks, we're very wealthy when it comes to the amount of public park space that we have. The added benefit is we have so much open space, which is the views over our ocean. So Carpinteria has a wonderful feel in that regard. When you look back at the mountains, there's a huge amount of open space you have visual access to. And it really is hard to imagine moving to a community that's flat, that is very developed with urban setting, and think I could ever be happy in a place like that. But yeah, no, Carpinteria does have, just our setting is so beautiful. And then you add the motivation of people here to do things like do the marsh park and to do the bluffs and even the smaller things like the creek park and tar pits park. And that's an interesting point about in the 50s, the oil companies came and they bought a lot of land. And they still are here today and still occupy a lot of land. But some of the things that occurred in that time, in a way, by accident or by circumstance, led to big open space acquisitions by the public. So for instance, the Bluffs, Chevron owned it, and they were ambivalent about developing it. And they did throw a couple development proposals out that were rejected, but they didn't vigorously pursue it for decades. And that allowed an opportunity later on when public open space was considered more precious by the general public to preserve it. Tar Pits Park is another great example. That was owned by Exxon. And when they put in Platform Habitat, which is a big natural gas producer 7 miles off the Carpinteria coast, they dedicated that to be public land. So the city acquired that in the wake of a Exxon oil and gas development project. The developed trails that we have through the bluffs and through the pier parking lot were funded by oil company obligations. So my point is just simply that by accident and by design, both, we've ended up with some very legacy park improvements and open space in the wake of oil projects.
When was the Tar Pits Park donated?
I think that's about 1987.
Okay.
Could be 83. I don't remember. I could tell you, though. I know I have the grant deed. Those are good things to do, nice pictures of these projects over my voice, so people aren't staring at me.
I'll try not to be on your face.
The pool.
Oh yeah, the pool. I'm going to get the, let's see, 952. 1 second. The community pool. Tell me about that.
The community pool was completed in June of 1989, So we're not too far off from our 25th anniversary of serving the community. And I got involved because I was requested to join the pool committee by Alex Nordholm, who had just the most passionate desire to have a community pool. He was very motivating, and he should be credited for the guy who made that happen, in my opinion. But it was
What did he do?
He motivated and organized a group and stuck with it and persisted. It was a difficult row to hoe. There were lots of people that said we don't need a pool in a beach community. There were people who thought it would never ever be used. Finding a location was very difficult. In those days, the middle school had a lot of land at the corner of Palm and Carpinteria Avenue that was in just kind of in disuse. So the school board at the time, I think, made a very good decision to allow the pool to be built there. The city was somewhat resistant because of the economics of a pool are never good. It's very difficult to recover your costs on operating a pool. But what is fascinating, in the end of the day, when you go to the pool, you'll find that it's always busy there. So we do get a tremendous amount of business. There's a lot of kids that learn to swim there. There's a lot of school-age children that strengthen their swimming schools, join the age group swim team. There's now a very strong high school aquatics program that's going. So we have men's and women's water polo and a swim team at the high school level. A lot of kids who have done water polo and swimming have gone on, and that's been an important part of their access to college through scholarships because of their sports involvement in aquatics. And then it's the adult swimming and the fitness that's going on and the seniors that are there. These are all very healthy things, and it's very consistent for a park system to have something that engages so many people in a healthy lifestyle. So I believe the pool has been a wise investment. It's not cheap, but neither are El Caro Park or Memorial Park to maintain and mow that grass or maintain those sports fields. When, if you were to go out to El Caro Park on a typical day, it's seldom, you know, as there's a few people there, but nothing organized. Go to the pool on a typical day, and it's full of people swimming. So I think the pool fares well when you consider the amount of use it gets from the community.
It was finished in 1983, did
you say? 1989. Yeah.
It was finished in 1989.
1989, so we're approaching our 25th year of service there. And I also would say that if you haven't, I suggest you go over and look at the tile walls, because there have been a series of fundraisers and they still are ongoing. But boy, that initial tile wall, and then the anniversary wall, and then the 10-year wall, and then the 20-year wall, all reflect a lot of names and businesses in Carpinteria that saw the wisdom of the pool. And it's almost like a little time capsule to see all those folks up there. Really, really cool. It's very, very powerful.
What about the controversy of when the gym was built next door and casting a shadow on the pool? Can you talk about that, how it was resolved?
Well, it was resolved that the gym was built. You know, I don't know if that should be a part of my interview, but what happened was the school district thought that they were exempt from the Coastal Act through an educational code. So they designed and built the whole, they didn't build it, but they designed the whole campus and spent a lot of money on design fees before they ever came in for review. And the city had to review and consider the consistency of the project with the Coastal Act. And so when they came in with a plan that was already highly developed, they were very resistant to change it, even though there were discretionary acts on the city that the city was compelled to do. If maybe discretionary is the wrong term, but the point being is, so there was conflict because the school district didn't think they were subject to the Coastal Act, and the city said they were. That contentiousness lasted for a little period of time until the opinion was rendered that no, the school district is very much subject to the Coastal Act, and there was a little dust up about things. So. I wouldn't include that in my stuff. But
okay, well.
Too late?
Well, if you don't want me to include it in the edited interview, I won't. But it happened during my stay here in town, and I remember that. You know, I kind of want to get in some of the controversies and some of the fallouts back together. And it kind of split the city and the school district some.
Yeah, there's a lot, over the years I've been involved, there have been some little dust-ups between the various agencies, and they can be personalities involved, and they can also be substantive disagreements. And in the case of the middle school remodel, which is a fine project, and it has come out very well, there was a big controversy. And it had to do with the city's jurisdiction in enforcing the Coastal Act. The Coastal Commission grants the city jurisdiction to enforce its Coastal Act, but if it fails to do so, the Coastal Commission has the right to claw that jurisdiction back, and that's a very bad thing. That has happened. The city of Malibu lost its ability to enforce its own general plan, because they were accused of not doing a good job, and for a while, they lost that privilege. So the city takes that role very seriously. And in the case of the school, they just simply and honestly thought they were exempt from it, because in other jurisdictions which are not in the coastal zone, they are exempt from the local planning department's actions. But in the coastal zone, that's not the case. So the experience of the administration of the school district at the time didn't know that. They argued that they were exempt, and they thought they were doing the right thing. But at the end of the day, it proved that, no, the Coastal Act does also control the school district's actions, especially when it comes to development projects. That just caused a little bit of animosity. But I will say that just a couple of short years later, the project was not funded well enough to complete the athletic facilities behind the middle school. And I don't know if you remember, but for a long time after the middle school was completed, the fields in back were left undone. Portables that were brought in to serve as temporary classrooms during construction were left on the fields. And I'm very happy to say that it was a partnership project with the city and the school district that got the project, the athletic fields, restored to where you see them today. That was a city parks and recreation project initiation, where we were able to attract a grant under another Parks Bond Act that the school district could not get. We were able to get it and steer those funds to that remodeling out there, which put the basketball courts, the tennis courts, the running track, and that big grass field in place. And the city did the lead on that until construction, where then we turned it over to the school district to actually build it. But we led, it was, Parks Department here that we did the design and did the permit processing and got that delivered. So going from a couple of years earlier being having a contentious relationship, a couple of years later we're all standing at a ribbon cutting in a partnership project, which just goes to show you we are very good at working with our adjacent government agencies. And I can say the same thing about the state park, where we had a very contentious relationship and worked to create a beautiful outcome of the Linden Field. And you'd go back, when I first got involved in the city, that was a dirt field that was not irrigated that the city had to endure, because the state park had no money and no interest in making that a nice field. It was their backyard, yet it was the city's front yard. And it's where one of our most aesthetically important areas existed, down by our waterfront. The olive branch that we sent out was, hey, let us manage that for you. We'll pay for the water. We'll pay for the maintenance. We want it to be better for all of us. And that's why the field has been such a success over the years. And it was building on that partnership that led to a little more trust and a little more faith in our building the Palm to Linden Trail and the Tomal Interpretive Play Area. So some of these interagency cooperation projects bears fruit way beyond the project itself.
Good lesson to know.
Well, I would honestly say I think that's what our constituency, I think that's what all the citizens of Carpinteria expect of us, is to work as efficiently and cooperatively as we possibly can. So,
just to not hash it out too much, but the issue with the middle school remodel and the pool, it had to do with the shadow over the pool. Can you tell me what the issue was and how it was resolved?
Well, yes, the school district had placed, I should say really, the school district's architect had placed the gymnasium where you see it today in their plan. And the city wanted to consider alternatives to that. And in those alternatives, was there a better place to put it? Was there an area that it could be placed further back? I think setbacks were the issue. And in debating whether the setback should be increased or decreased, but mostly the argument was it should be increased, setback from Carpinteria Avenue. One of the benefits of setting it back further was to reduce the shadow it casts on the pool. And it does indeed cast a shadow on the pool. And it does cause a minor change in the energy requirements of the pool because it's not getting the solar, the direct solar benefit. We know that in the summertime, when the sun is high and the pool gets the maximum amount of solar exposure, we have no heating bills. And the more we get into winter and the cooler the day and the less sun exposure the pool gets, we have increasing heating bills for the pool water. And being in the shadow of a gym is certainly more likely to lead to higher higher heating bills. It's also not as nice for the patrons to be in the shadow. So that was just one of the arguments about how the design of the middle school might be evolved. But as I said earlier, the school district had already completed all of its design and was not really that interested in making modifications based upon the city's comments.
Okay, let's see. Anything to do with the demographics? We have older demographics now, and I think that's the trend. Do you have any comments about the future? Community pool we just discussed. There have been some controversies to do with the state park. You kind of mentioned a little bit of the contentiousness. City park condemned how the state park, or the city condemned how the state park was run. I think in the maybe 60s or 70s, I'm not sure that was.
I wasn't involved, but I know that it's what I walked into. That level of animosity between the city and the state was existed from the 70s, really. And so now it's the early 80s, and I'm getting involved, and I'm running into the contempt that each agency held for each other. And the community was not happy either. When I first started getting involved with Tar Pits Park, I heard stories about how the state fenced off the entire park, which cut off a huge amount of access of the community toward the ocean. And that really was a driver. The state felt as though they should fence it off. That's the way they operate in all their other units. So it was just a little bit of a difference when you have a unit that's completely surrounded by an urban area.
When was that they fenced it off?
You know, these are stories I've heard, so it had to be in the 70s, maybe even earlier, but people sometimes don't forget these things. And the fences didn't last long because so many people just cut them. I mean, the reaction was to vandalize the fences. But when I got involved, I was part of a new city management in a way. The city manager had retired. The police chief had moved on. And the city staff had turned over, but at that time the state park staff had not yet turned over. So the state park staff was still holding on to some angst and still was holding that grudge against the city a little bit. And it took a little bit of time to say and prove that there were some things that we could do together that gave us both what we were looking for. So we found common ground on a lot of things, and our relationship has been as good now as it's ever been, so I think that's an important milestone.
Nice. Anything about landmarks you can discuss during the last 50 years? Torrey Pines, 67, 68, Heath Park, Adobe, 75?
Yeah, I don't really have any thing of too interest.
Okay. flooding. You did kind of talk about some flooding. Is there any flooding stories or issues?
Just oceanfront flooding for me. Yeah, that was beach flood fighting.
Talked about droughts and water issues. Let me change. Any thoughts? Can you tell me about that?
Well, the Thunderbolt from the old days was the, you know, the car racing facility out on Bluffs 3. And there's, you know, fun old posters about that, but I wasn't a part of that. The Thunderbolt roller hockey rink was a product of a lot of interested parents that wanted to have a roller hockey league for their kids. And the city allowed the construction of that out there on the very eastern portion of the City Hall campus. They leased it to the Optimists of Carpinteria, which was a nonprofit group that allowed roller hockey league to be run out on the premises. And it was all funded through donations and all operated through their user fees. But the roller hockey is a very organized sport. You got to have some number of teams to have interest. And it was, in a way, not durable. So after the motivated group of parents and kids grew up, there were no successors. So it fell into disuse. And it sat there a few times. People thought about starting it up again. We had some interest from some roller derby folks or some other potential uses that needed an arena style of facility, but nothing came to fruition. So after a while, the city started using it for storage. The roles of the city, you know, the services that we provide have grown somewhat. So the equipment we need is more diverse, and some of the things that we do is requires more storage. So it became irresistible for the city to start storing things out there. In the late 80s, we had a skate park? Was that be late 80s or even maybe early 90s?
Before we go on to that, Thunderbolt, when was that built about?
I want to say it must have been around 1992 or 3.
Okay. And any thoughts why it lost interest, like just fluky thing that these people happen to be interested and others aren't, or was there less?
Well, like I say, it had a real going thing for a while, and, you know, leagues would come in, age groups, and of course it's a very involved, very organized sport to be successful. There's no individual aspect to it in the sense that you don't go off and do roller hockey by yourself. So, like football, you know, think of all the organization it takes to have a football team and a football game and to be in a league of football. Same with roller hockey. So after the motivated initial group kind of went through the system and their children grew up, there were no successors. So it just dwindled away to into disuse. And we weren't quick to convert it to any other use. It sat there for a while, and like I say, we got a couple of inquiries about maybe using it for roller derby or a workout area for this or that. We had a few community concerts out there, but it, like I say, became an irresistible storage yard. Sitting there vacant mostly.
Then the skate park, the temporary skate park at the train station. Do you know about when that was, and can you tell me about that?
You know, I'm fuzzy on the dates, but I do remember that was, again, motivated parents who felt like we should have a safe place for children to practice skateboarding. And it was at a time when skateboarding was rising in popularity, and the conflicts of skateboarding on sidewalks was a big motivator because the city was enforcing regulations like we would about riding bikes down the sidewalk. The public was complaining about infrastructure damage to curbs and gutters and benches and anything else a skateboarder might bounce off of. The schools were enforcing no skateboarding on their campuses. And the question of where does a skateboarder go to skate where it's legal became more and more of a drive. And at the same time, the sport was evolving to include half pipes and rails to grind and quarter pipes and those sorts of things. With the motivation of the parents, the city council agreed to allow the Parks Department to occupy a portion of parking lot number 3, and with a volunteer team of builders. I remember Barry Horowitz was one builder in particular who was involved, and there were others, but the contributions and fundraising efforts led to the purchase of all the materials, and the volunteer corps of builders put up a pretty nice park, and there was a couple of experts that came in to lead to a competent park design. And at the time, it was a novelty. There weren't many skate parks. It was way ahead of a Santa Barbara facility or a Ventura facility. So it drew a lot of skaters from a wide region. And it was a magnet facility, really. And skateboarding or skateboard practicers, they range in age from 8 or 9 all the way up to 30. So that's a very, pretty diverse group. And it was a learning experience. Skaters were, a lot of them were having a great time, and we had a little bit of difficulty with a few. So it led to a little bit of animosity between the law enforcement, between some of the seniors. Some of the out-of-towners would come in and act nefariously there, smoke cigarettes or bring glass bottles in, maybe bring alcohol in. They became difficult to enforce and too much time consumed by the sheriff's department trying to enforce them. And the overall feel of the facility was not good. At the same time, after 2.5 years, it started to wear out. As a wooden facility, it became clear that it was going to have to be closed for major renovation. But because of the circumstances, there wasn't motivation at the time to spend the money to renovate it. And it went away. We pretty much tore it down. So now a decade later, there's a new movement afoot. The sport has evolved from that time in a lot of ways. One of the ways is that a lot of the kids that were skating or who were of the age to skate then are now parents. And the number of skate park facilities around us has grown exponentially and nationwide. So instead of a little bit of an outlaw culture, in my opinion, that many skaters had, it's much, much less so. And just like any sporting facility that's outdoors, a basketball court or a skate park or a tennis court, you might have a couple of bad characters that might participate in the sport, but it doesn't stain all of the participants in the sport. And that's why I think that a skate park and the concept of one in a park system has evolved and matured to the point where it becomes an appropriate one for Carpinteria.
Any thoughts where it might be?
Well, currently we're evaluating the site where the old roller hockey rink was, so the Thunderbolt site. It is in that site has potential in many ways because it's no longer a controversy as being too close to residences. And it's difficult to install a park, an active sports park near any kind of residential area because of the potential for noise and traffic. And here's a site that can be night lit. Here's a site that can be big enough to accommodate a lot of skaters and maybe even draw some, kind of regionally, some skaters. And that gives it a better business profile because, like any park, it's going to have funding to maintain it. So if there's a opportunity to have some fundraisers or again make it have a little entrepreneurial activity around the park that helps fund its existence, that's a good thing.
The liability with a skate park are not insurmountable, I think.
They're not insurmountable, and the statistics that are generated nationally and statewide don't support the notion that a skate park is any more dangerous than any other park. We have pretty good data on that now. That's another part of the sport that's matured, is we can see that the number of injuries are even less than soccer. Oddly, the first month that you start to skateboard is your most likely period to be hurt. Go figure.
The one downside I heard about having it at a roller hockey rink is it's farther from downtown. happen, but any thoughts about that?
Well, yeah, but I mean, it's not very far from downtown. And so, yes, it is farther from downtown, but it's not very far. Everything's pretty close. And there are benefits that won't be available downtown if you have it. If we had it downtown, like let's suggest the 5th Street site, there would probably have to be much fewer hours for noise control. There would probably be no chance to light it. There'd be no chance to have like any kind of music event to help fundraise for it. And a lot of those benefits of being here, I think, more than outweigh the convenience of having it closer to the downtown. I don't do Orchard the Ocean, anything to do with that.
Did you want to say anything about the triathlon?
Well, the triathlon is a fun event. It is one that brings a lot of tourism into Carpinteria. We have a few, you know, a good representation of Carpinterians that participate in the triathlon, but the vast majority of participants are from out of town. And it showcases the community a bit when we do that. And I'm always proud of that. It showcases the beauty of our beach, the beauty of our surroundings, and it also, I think, it showcases our wonderful little downtown area that is good for business.
Well, when did it start?
We're about to enter our 18th, so 97 maybe, 98, something like that.
And describe what a triathlon is.
The tri in triathlon is for three sports. You swim, you bike, and you run. And the distances vary, but the long distance that we have is a 1.5K bike, a 1.5K swim, a 25K or kilometer bike ride, and a 5K run, 10K. Yeah. There's a short course and a long course, but it takes the better athletes on the long course about 2 hours to complete the event. The very best ones break 2 hours, and then right in that 2 hour, 10 minutes, you get a big group of pretty accomplished athletes. But some people take all the way up to maybe the better part of 3.5 hours. And I enjoy Carpinteria's triathlon. Always, people ask me, why don't I do the triathlon? Well, I do it every year. I'm just there running around. I think I cover more area than the actual athletes do. But the fun part is, without being coached, people who come in late in the triathlon get a huge and roaring round of applause, just like the guys who come in first. So that just shows Carpinteria's spirit. I think it really has been a big reason for the success of the event over the 18 years we've done it.
I'm also, I'm sorry, you were saying, you grew up where?
I mentioned earlier that my great-grandfather and great-uncle settled in 1869 here in Carpinteria. And my mother's side of the family, my grandfather and grandmother, and then my mother and her siblings all grew up in Carpinteria. But my mom went to college at Scripps down in Claremont and met my dad, who was going to Pomona. So I spent my childhood growing up in a suburb of Los Angeles called La Cañada. But it was very fortunate that my mother wanted to still have a lot of time in Carpinteria. So with the help of my aunt, they purchased a little sandy beachfront lot in 1953. Which is going to be on the Carpinteria Beautiful Home Tour this year.
Wow, nice.
Nice. And we've had this place to go since 1953, so we would come up every summer and many times during the year and visit Carpinteria and stay at our little beach house, which back then, I remember it very clearly, it was before any development was between the beach and the railroad tracks. So it was a clear shot. You could see the train go by.
Really?
The Solomar Sands and some of the other apartments that built down Holly long since blocked that view, of course. But the childhood experiences that I've had growing up here. And I told you, I developed a real affection for taking a little rowboat offshore and running a little outboard motorboat and going out to the reef and fishing or snorkeling. And that's reflected in some of the things I've done as parks director, building the boathouse that's full of kayaks and stand-up paddleboards, so that kids that are here have the same access I used to enjoy as a kid growing up, because I always felt that was magical, and I think it should be something enjoyed by many people. So it wasn't until about 1980 that I graduated from college and came back here. And as I mentioned earlier, in 1980, in June, I got a call from a friend who said, we need a lifeguard, and that started my career with the city of Carpinteria.
Is there any footage that you may get to me that you can talk about? You know, the Dory Championship maybe was a little earlier than 65.
Yeah, it could have been.
It's the Good Morning America that they talked about that.
I have some footage that was taken on VCR of recording the Good Morning America show on ABC when Carpinteria was named as one of the top 10 beaches in the nation. Kind of an exciting moment, and this was Dr. Beach, who was a Florida university professor, and he started this very great idea of naming the top 10 beaches. So Carpinteria was on there, and it was a real surprise to many, many people. And it was the very first year he created that list, which was nice because then people started competing for it as opposed to just being given it as a surprise award. So Dr. Beach got pulled in many directions, and I think he was influenced to provide that award to others because the Chamber of Commerce just went wild. But we got it first. We were in the I think we might have been number 10, but hey, we'll take it.
Do you remember about what year that was?
I don't. I would have to say it might have been about the very late 90s.
And is there any other footage you have that may be useful to me?
I have footage of John Humphreys being featured on Good Morning America as one of the nation's oldest lifeguards. And I hired him as a beach lifeguard because he passed the swim test. And good for him. I have footage of...
And when would he have been recognized?
That might have been 2000 and something, 2003 or 4.
Okay.
I have footage, a couple tapes of the city getting awards at the California Parks and Recreation Society. One was for the community pool. Another one was for a piece of promotional literature we did for our summer programming. I think we might have gotten another award there somewhere. I can't remember. But I have that video that goes way back to where that shows Sand Point as a sand spit, but that goes into the 30s. So that video is kind of rare because not many people had movie cameras back then for private use. But I'll have to look through my archives. I have several. I have an old promotional videos that you did and even Johnny Bristol did of the Junior Lifeguard program.
Nice. Do any big news stories come to mind over the last 50 years that you didn't discuss?
Well, not that I didn't discuss, but the one that was the most miraculous in my view was when in 13 to 14 weeks the money was raised to buy the Bluffs. That was, I wouldn't have predicted that ever. And it happened, and it was quite a legacy moment in Carpinteria's history.
Well, Matt, thank you for your wonderful service. Good interview.
Thanks for doing this.
And I really appreciate it.
Don't embarrass me.